Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yeah, thank you. Now I'm going to present now.
Sir, are you recording the session?
Yeah.
I mean, have you started?
Yeah, just started recording. Thanks for reminding me.
Thank you.
Actually, I forgot. Just now started.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Are you able to see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Please mute. Whenever you talk, unmute and speak, then suddenly speak, mute it. Okay. So building system technology used. I used this, I used Java 8, Spring Boot 2.3.3 and Lombak library, MapStruct, FlywayDB and MySQL. These are the things I used in the building system project. Okay. Before going to building system project, I want to tell something, some basic information I want to tell. This information is very useful for people who don't have much information about the Spring Boot, Spring Framework. Okay. This is a very fundamental information I'm going to share with you. Why I choose Spring Boot to develop a building system? Not only me, every company in the world, if you, they are working with Java means they are choosing a Spring Boot, right? Why that is happening? Why they are not using Struts framework? Why they are not using JSF? Why they are not using legacy Java? Legacy Java meaning 10 to 15 years back, if you want to develop any web application, any standalone application, they have to use Java, JDK, JDK kit plus Tomcat and JSP, Sowlet. They have to use that kind of technology. They are going to develop the web application, right? That is, I am saying legacy Java EG. Okay. Then after some time, they moved from that. They started using Struts framework, JSF, those things. After Spring framework coming to the market, everything is gone. Everything is gone. What magic happened in a Spring framework? That we need to know. Why everybody likes Spring framework? Let's say I want to develop a web application. For example, I want to develop a job website, job site. Okay. For the job site, we need to do so many things. If you want to develop a web application, we need to take care of DB connection, DB configuration, then connection management, transaction management, and managing Java object. This thing not part of job site, right? This task not part of job functionalities. Apart from job functionalities, we need to take care of this environmental related stuff. This thing we need to take care of. How to connect a DB, how to manage a connection, how to manage a transaction, how to manage a Java object that we are using in the project. This thing we have to take care. For that, we need to write a lot of code. We need to manage that code. Okay, that is a separate task. For that will take some time. Company need to pay for that to the people, right, who is developing. Also time consuming. These are all the problem having in legacy Java EE. Legacy Java is a good, okay, that is using legacy Java only, they developed Spring Boot, Spring Framework, every technology, that's fine. But if you are using legacy Java EE directly, you need to take care this information, these things by you, okay. That is time consuming also. It is very difficult to manage those things. To avoid those problems, to avoid those things, Spring Framework come into the picture. If you want to connect database connection, if you want to manage your view, that is JSP or whatever view, it's a velocity, time leaf, there are many views, right? If you want to view the front end, if you want to manage the DB connection, if you want to manage the database transaction, if you want to manage your Java object, everything taken care by Spring Framework. You don't have to write any code. If you want, those code we are call it as a boilerplate code. If you want to manage DB connection, we have to write some set of code. That code we are call it as a boilerplate code. We don't have to write those kind of code. We need to configure Spring Framework. If you want to connect a MySQL database, if you want to connect DB to, just we have to configure. That's it. If you want to work with JSP, for JSP, we need to configure the view in the Spring Framework. Then if you want to manage Beano, Java object, you are created in Spring Framework. You don't have to worry about that. The main feature of a Spring Framework is a dependency injection, IOC, inversion of controller. Through that Spring framework, managing all the Java object we are created. Okay, whenever we create a Java object, that Java object will be available in the IOC container. How to register the IOC container? We're going to use some annotations like a service annotation, component annotation. If you use that annotation for a class, that meaning you are registering your class inside a IOC container. Once you deployed inside IOC container, that Java lifecycle taken care by your Spring framework. You don't have to do anything. Also, this IOC container gives loosely coupled application. Okay, I will tell later what is loosely coupled application. Okay, using loosely coupled application, we can write very good test cases. If you want to test some particular class, we can write very powerful test cases using loosely coupled application. Spring framework provide to create a loosely coupled application. Okay, that is another benefit. Loosely coupled applications are easily unit tested. Okay, we can easily unit test. I will tell how it's easy. Okay, the next. Then, good integration with other framework like ORM tool, Hibernate, iBatis. For example, today I am using Hibernate for database management. Tomorrow I am thinking I want to use iBatis or some other persistent framework. If you want to do that, you can easily do in Spring framework. We can remove the Hibernate, we can plug the some other framework. Also, I want to send email, I want to generate some reports. If you want to do in Spring framework, we can get that library, I can plug that library in the Spring framework. That is the beauty of Spring framework. Spring framework, we can call it as an adaptive technology. It's an adaptive technology. If you want anything, we can use it. If you don't want, you can remove it. That is another feature of Spring framework. Okay, what is tightly coupled code, loosely coupled code? If you look at here, user controller. The user controller class, I am using private user service. User service equal to new user service. In this particular picture, I am using new keyword, right? Whenever you use new keyword, that becomes tightly coupled code. That is, user controller class highly dependent on user service. Without user service class, user control cannot work. But I am thinking, I want to test only user controller. That is not possible. Other technology. But Spring framework, since Spring framework provide loosely coupled code, we can bypass this particular service class itself. Without using this, we can test only user controller. That meaning user control is not highly dependent on user service. When you look at here, the loosely coupled code, I am saying at AutoWire. At AutoWire means what you are doing? At AutoWire means you are registering the user service inside a IOC, you are requesting the user service from the IOC container. Correct? In the Spring framework, I want to test only user controller. In that case, I can use Markito framework, Spring MEC. Using those framework, you can test only user controller. We can test only user controller without user service help. We don't have to worry about this user service class. We can test only user controller. Okay, that is called as a loosely coupled code. In Spring framework, provide loosely coupled code. Because of that, we can write very powerful test cases. Say, whenever you develop application, you have a presentation layer, you have a service layer, you have a DAO layer, right? 1 minute. Yeah. When you develop any application, these are basic layers, presentation layer, service layer, DAO layer. Once you complete the presentation layer, I want to test only presentation layer. I want test only service layer. I want test only DAO layer. That is possible in Spring Framework without depending on service layer, without depending on DOA layer, we can do because Spring Framework provides loosely coupled code. Okay. Okay. Then, so okay, Spring Framework provides this many features. Why we need to go for Spring Boot? Yeah, most of the people think that Spring Framework and Spring Boot is a different technology. That is not like that. Please change your mindset. Spring Framework, Spring Boot is the same technology. They are not competitor. They are not competitor with each other. They are solving a different problem. Whatever I explained, right? Spring Framework solving that. Everything we can do by configuration without writing code, we can implement something using Spring Framework. For example, DB connection, then sending Java object management, transaction management. Those things we don't have to write any code. Through some configuration, we can achieve. That is that feature provided by Spring Framework. All Java object managed by Spring Framework. That feature provided by Spring Framework. Okay, these many features available in Spring Framework. Then why Spring Boot? On top of Spring Framework, Spring Boot provides some enhancement, some cosmetic things is giving. That is, Spring Boot thinks that differently than Spring Framework. The Spring Framework, we need to configure everything. Spring Boot saying that, hey, dude, you don't have to configure anything. I will take care. Okay, that is the beauty of Spring Boot. You don't have to configure anything. Whenever you develop any web application, everything taken care by, all configuration taken care by Spring Boot technology. That is Spring Boot provide one feature called auto configuration. For example, if you want to develop a MVC in the Spring, I don't know how many people are already worked with the Spring Framework. If anyone worked with Spring Framework, they know value of Spring Boot. If anyone worked with Spring Boot, they don't know the value of the Spring Framework. They don't know the value of the Spring Boot. For example, I want to develop one simple web application. Okay, I want to develop one simple web application in Spring Framework, not Spring Boot. If you want to develop Spring web application in Spring Framework, for that, you need to add so many artifacts in your POM.xml file. So many artifacts in your POM.xml file. This is the POM.xml file, right? Let's say I want to develop one web application using Spring Framework. In such a case, in the POM.xml file, you should know how many jar file, how many artifacts we need to add here. There are list of artifacts we need to add in order to develop a web application in Spring Framework. Without knowing that, you cannot do that. Like that, if you want to add some Hibernate, if you want to add some JDBC connection, for that, you need to add some artifact in your POM.xml. Spring Boot provide dependency issues. Spring Boot resolve the dependency issues. But Spring Framework not resolving the dependency issues. We should know what is a dependency to develop this application. But Spring Boot not like that. Whenever you add some starter project, I will tell later what is starter project. Whenever I add some starter project, through that starter project, everything automatically configured by your Spring Boot application. That is a beauty of Spring Boot. If you want to tell layman terminology, for example, I want to prepare a coffee. I want to drink a coffee. What you will do? You should know how to prepare a coffee. To prepare a coffee, we need some raw material: sugar, milk, water, then coffee powder. These are all the raw material to prepare a coffee. Okay, if you know, then only you can prepare a coffee. Otherwise, you cannot prepare a coffee. That is called as a Spring Framework. Spring Boot is nothing but a vending machine, coffee vending machine. You don't have to know anything about it. Directly go and press button. It will give you the coffee. That is called as a Spring Boot. Everything available in Spring Boot. Just you have to generate the project, start working it. That's it. That is the beauty of Spring Boot. Spring Boot resolve the dependency management issues. Spring Boot provide auto configuration. This is my building system project. When you look at your POM.xml file, I will give you the one example here. See here, Spring Boot started web. This is a web application starter project. These artifacts for web application starter project. If you add only this artifact, that's enough. If you add this artifact, that's enough. You are done with the web application configuration. Why? Because when you click here, I am clicking here. When you click, it will take you to another pom.xml file. When you look at here, there are many artifacts already defined here. Many artifacts. Okay. This artifact needed for develop web application. This artifact you don't have to include manually by you. Everything taken care by your Spring Boot starter project. Spring Boot provides many starter projects. Each starter project will do some operation. For that operation, we need some library. That library provided by your Spring Boot starter project. Okay. For example, started web. This started web provide all artifact here. Whenever you start the application, this will download this jar file. Those jar file copied in your Spring Boot ClassPath library. By reading that jar file, Spring Boot automatically do the auto configuration. For example, in the web application, I added this dependency. Whenever you start the application, it will go here. See here, the external library. The external library, you can see a lot of jar files. See Spring Framework related jar files, everything, Spring Security and Spring Web MEC, Spring Web, then Spring Boot Core. There are many jar files downloaded through this artifact. Whenever you start the application, your Spring Boot read this jar file. By reading this jar file, this come to know that, okay, we want to configure Spring MEC for this project. So it will automatically configure. In the Spring framework, not like that. If you want to develop a web application, you need to configure view, which view you want to work. If you want to work with JSP, if you want to work with REST API, you need to configure that particular resource view inside a Spring framework. If you then you need to configure dispatcher servlet in the Spring framework. But in the Spring Boot, you don't have to configure dispatcher servlet. It will configure by automatically everything. That is the beauty of Spring Boot. Okay. Here another starter project, starter data JPA. This is for database related stuff. Whenever you want to connect the database, we need to create a data source, right? The data source automatically created by your Spring Boot application. The data source automatically created by Spring Boot application by adding your DB URL and the DB username and the password. That's it. That rest of the stuff taken care by your Spring Boot application. Okay. This is the advantages of Spring Boot when compared to Spring Framework. Spring Framework is a core technology. Without that, we cannot do anything. Spring Framework doing everything for you. Spring Boot doing only two tasks. One is auto configuration and another one is dependency issue. You don't have to worry about the dependency. Every dependency taken care by Spring Boot. Okay guys, this is what I want to explain about the Spring Boot, Spring Framework and legacy JEE. If you have any question, let me know. Now I'm going to jump into our project. This is our billing system. No questions, right?
No, sir.
Okay. This is our billing system project structure. You can see here. Controller, entity, then mappers. I will tell what is a mapper. Then services, validator, entity, DTO. There are category wise I created a package. Each package contains some related classes. Okay. Okay, let's assume that you deployed your Spring Boot you deployed a billing system application in your local machine. After the completion of the session, I will share the source code with you through some link, either the Google Drive or I'll put the source code. You start deploying that billing system in your local machine. Okay. I will give the guide. I will give the some links. Okay. Through that, you can deploy it. From today onwards, you need to start deploying the billing application in your local machine. Then only we can complete at the fifth day. My agenda is, but the fifth day, everybody should deploy the billing system in your local machine. You must be able to play with all REST endpoint that is implemented in billing system, so that after completion of the session, please start work on deploying the billing system. Okay, I will give you the guide, everything. Through that, you can follow the step, you can start. If you stuck anything, tomorrow day time, also you can ping me. If I'm available, definitely I will help you. Otherwise, after some time, I will help you. Okay. Okay. Let's say I sell this project, sell this product to the one retailer shop. Let's say the medical shop. I sold this product to medical shop. We deployed everything. We deployed the billing system is up and running. Okay. Once up and running, is it possible to play with it immediately? That is not possible, because we need to set up something. We need to set up something. We need to load some data. We need to load the product data. Then only we can sell through our billing system. After successful deployment, there are some steps we need to follow. Okay. This is the 8 endpoints we need to work on to set up the billing system. The first endpoint you can see API public ORGs. Second endpoint saying API public authenticate. Other endpoints are saying private, private, private. Whenever you develop any REST endpoint, you need to follow some standards. Okay. Without following standards also, that REST endpoint will work. That is no problem. Okay. But you have to follow some standards. By seeing that endpoint, that user can understand, okay, this is this endpoint doing this operation, this endpoint doing this operation, like that, that end user, that is client, can understand easily. By using this public and public word, we can understand that this particular endpoint is publicly accessible. This here I'm saying everything private, private, private. This endpoint cannot access publicly. Whenever you want to access any endpoint that available with the private, you need to authorize. Once you authorize, then only you can use that endpoint. Okay. In order to play with that billing system, first you need to create an organization. First you need to create an organization. As I told that I am selling to the medical shop owner. The medical shop nothing but it's a company, right? It's a one small company. We have to enter the company information. Part of the company information, you have to tell who is the owner of the company. That thing we can achieve through this first endpoint. Okay. I am using a Postman to play with the billing system. That is a common tool everybody will use, right? If you have any other tool, you can use it, no problem. But my suggestion is to use the Postman. This is my MySQL workbench. This is the table I am using for billing system. Okay. Now I will go to remove all the tables. I will go and drop every table now. Drop 23 table. So yeah, all tables are dropped. Okay. I want to start the application now. Run billing system application. Yeah, server is started successfully. This is running under 9091, port number 9091. I already removed all the table. After successful setup, whenever you start the application, what will happen? Automatically, it will create all the tables that needed. That is happening through Flyway DB framework. I am using Flyway DB framework in this billing system. Through this, we can manage database side. Okay, creating a table and changing a table. We can track the history. I will tell later about that. Okay, not today. In the resource section, there is one folder called DB migration. You can see here some SQL files. These SQL files contain the table definitions. Whenever you start the application, it will read this table information and create automatically in your database. If I go to database, refresh it. See here, all tables are available here. It's created. Now, nothing is, no data is in this table. All data is empty table. Now, I want to create a one organization owner. I want to create a one owner. Okay. For that, I need to fill organization table. Then, this table contains organization information. Then I want to populate user table. Whenever you create organization, part of this organization one user will create. That user data populate here. Each user will have address, right? That address will populate in address table. Now these three tables are empty, right? Now we're going to create through our rest endpoint. This is an organization rest endpoint. If you want to create any organization, we need to use this rest endpoint. It has some request body. I'll open this, I'll copy this, I will show here. This is the request body I have to send from the client to backend, from the client side. Now Postman is the client side. Now my Postman is a client application. From the client application, I want to send a request. This request I am sending. Okay, I want to send this request. This request go to the backend side. Backend will read this request data and convert as a Java object. That Java object store it to the database. Now this entire request is the organization. Inside organization, we have a user. Instead of your user, you have an address array list. One user can have multiple address. That's the reason I make it as an array, address as an array list. Okay. We need to send this information to the our billing system server. I'll go and send now. See, 201 created. But if you notice here, I am saying 201 created. The most of the people when work with the rest endpoint, whenever they success, the rest endpoint is success, they will simply say, okay, that is success. We should not do that. Whenever you create some object, some resource, whenever you create some resource inside a server, that time we need to say one HTTP method called 201, that is created. That meaning it's saying that organization resource created inside a server. That is the meaning of this particular status. Okay. I copy this. Paste it here. This is the response of organization. After creating organization, we're creating a response. They receive the response. It generates one organization code. It automatically system generates an organization code. Then user detail, then address detail, then it will create. If you are creating any user through organization, whenever you create an organization, one user will create, right? That user is a owner of the user. That user role is a super admin role. You can do anything with that system. That is the meaning. User type is a owner. Then success. That is no need. That is nothing. Will this is just a message. Ignore this. User type equal to owner. Okay. Now we'll go and see the database. See organization record created. this organization data mapped with one user ID called one. When you go to user table, user ID is a one. That user is having suresh@bmp.com, Suresh Stalin, mobile number, everything is there. Then if you look at address table, this user ID one mapped here. See, address populated. We'll look at the user ID. Oh, user ID is giving null. We need to, there is some fix I need to do that. Okay. This user ID belongs to this particular, this address belongs to the particular user. Okay. So we created successfully one organization. Then part of this organization, we created one user. That's it. So this is the organization structure, organization inside a user, inside an address. Okay. In the address, user ID is not stored. I know why it's not stored. Okay. I did some changes today. That's the reason it's not storing. I know that. I fixed and set the code. Okay. Okay. Now we created an organization. Part of the organization, we created the user. Now using that user, we can play the rest endpoint. Whatever rest endpoint we have implemented the billing system, we can play. If you want to play the rest endpoint that implemented the billing system, you cannot directly go and play. If you want to access any rest endpoint, that user must authorize. User must authorize, okay? Without authorization, we cannot play with any rest endpoint. The first endpoint we have completed. Second endpoint is authenticate. Second endpoint is authenticate. Okay. Using that is also publicly accessible. Everyone can access. In this endpoint, they have to provide username and a password. Username and a password. Once you provided username and a password, your billing system, our billing system, validate that username and a password. If it is valid, it will generate one big string. It will generate one big authorization string. That authorization string is called as a JWT, JSON Web Token. I am using JWT as an authorization in this billing system. Okay. Whenever you provide username and password, our billing system generate JSON Web Token. That is a big encrypted string. Okay. Once you generate that big string, you need to use that string to work with other endpoint, to work with other rest endpoint. For example, I want to create a tax information. I want to create a vendor. I want to create a category. If you want to work with this endpoint, you need to use JSON Web Token. You need to pass that JSON Web Token. Your server read that JSON Web Token, decrypt that token. If the user is valid, then it's allowed to work with taxes. It allowed to work with vendor. Otherwise, it never allowed. Now we're going to see how to authenticate the username and the password, how to generate the JSON Web Token. Okay. So this is the authentication endpoint. It's a post method. Here you have to pass username and a password. Whenever you pass the username and password, it will validate and return the response. Let's do now. One more thing I want to show before that. There is one table called JWT token table. In this table, I am going to store that token information. The token information and the token will expire at particular time. Okay, it's not a long life token. The token will going to expire often. Okay, whenever you expire, we need to regenerate. The token information I am storing JWT token table. Okay, I am sending that request. See, we got the successful response. See here, access token, refresh token, then this message, authentication success, message type info. If message is error, it gives message type error. Okay. When you see here, it's generating access token, the refresh token. I will tell you what is the purpose of refresh token. Access token is a token. Using this token, we need to work with other rest endpoint. That is, I want to create a tax information. You cannot directly access this tax endpoint because a private method, private endpoint. It's not accessible publicly. But if you want to use this tax endpoint, you need to send this token. You need to send this token along with this endpoint. Okay. Server read this token and server read this token, encrypt this token, then check the username is valid or not. If it is valid, it allowed to use this tax ref endpoint. Okay. Now I'll copy this token. Let's see what is there inside the token. When you look at here, you can see that three section with a dot. This is the first section, this is the second section, this is the third section. This on web token separated with a dot, the three section. Okay, the first section is called as a header section, the third section call it as a payload section, that is claims. They call it as a claims. Claims meaning here you can pass any data along with username. If you want to pass some additional information, you can pass. Third section is a signature. Combination of these two portions is called as a signature. Okay, now I want to decrypt this. Let's see what is there inside a token. There is a one site called JWT.io where you can decrypt manually. Just to copy your refresh token, sorry, access token. See here, the first portion is a saying header. In the header, it says what is the algorithm it's using for encrypt. It says that H.256 algorithm we're using for encrypt. Third one is a payload. In this payload section, we can tell any data. Sub nothing but subject, that is username. Username, which user you use to log in, that user information coming here. EXP and IAT. EXP nothing but expiration date. These are long format of expiration date. IAT. IAT is a issued at. That meaning when this token generated. That is the information. Apart from this information, if you want to add some other information, we can add. For example, I want to add my country information, you can add it. I want to add some employee information, you can add it. See, apart from this information, if you want to add any information, you can add part of payload. Combination of these two section is called as a signature, header and the payload. Okay. Now, I hope you understand what is a JWT now. Okay. This JWT generated successfully. Let's check the database. Yeah, data get populated here. Okay. Now I generated the token to access the other private endpoint, right? To access the other private endpoint, I generated this token. Now I want to use this access token to work with other private endpoint. Let me copy this. Copied, then go to the postman. Okay, now I want to access the tax. I want to create no tax. We'll try with category now. Okay, later we'll talk with tax because if we start with tax, I want to explain more information. Okay, so we'll take it later. Before that, I want to work with categories. There is a one more endpoint category, right? In order to play with billing system, we need to create category also. Okay, now I want to create a category. If you want to access this endpoint, we need to send the JSON web token. I already copied that. In that header section, you need to pass one header value. That the header name is authorization. For that header, you need to pass this token. The token format must be like this: bearer space, then token, whatever token we have generated, that token we need to pass. Then go to the body section. The body section, we need to pass that category data. If you want to send category data, I'm using this category info as a request object. The category info, we need to pass category code. Category code, we don't have to pass, that will generate. Category name and the category description, we need to pass. Okay. I am doing the same here. Category name and the description I'm passing here. First, I want to try without authorization. Let's see what's happening. See here, access denied, forbidden. This endpoint cannot be accessed without authorization. Now I want to enable the authorization. I already copied here. See here, category created, 201 category created. After creating category, it's giving the response here. When you look at the category table, where is the category table? Categories. Okay. See, category code generated. Description menswear. Name menswear. Okay. Category generator. Through this way only, we need to access the endpoint in our billing system. Not only here. Wherever you go, there is authorization, right? There is a several authorization mechanism we have. I am choosing JWT here. Okay. If you want to access any endpoint, we need to authorize. We need to generate the token. Through that token only we can access any endpoint. Okay. I'm going back to this. 1 minute, guys. Here you can see access token, refresh token. Here we have two type of tokens. Why we need two type of tokens? Access token is for to accessing particular resource from the server. If you want to access any resource, if you want to create any resource to the server, we need to send this token to the server. Server validate this particular token. If it is valid, it will give the proper response. That is the purpose of access token. I told access token is not a long live token. It will expire some point of time. This is the access token expiration date. Access token expiration is it will going to expire this particular time. After this time, this token will not work. What we will do for that? Again, we need to generate access token. Okay. Whenever client generate this particular authorization, the server give two token, access token, refresh token. These two information, the client people keep it somewhere else. Okay. Whenever this token get expired, the client will send this refresh token. Saying that, hey, my access token is expired. Please give new access token by providing this refresh token. Once you provided this refresh token, server validate this refresh token. If it is valid refresh token, again generate new access token. Then client use that new access token, they can proceed their further task. That is the purpose of refresh token. Okay. Any question, guys, so far?
So this access token is used to create or receive any data, right?
Yeah, receive the resource or create the resource inside the server.
Okay.
Okay. But all the codes are available here. Okay. I will going to tell the third or fourth session which class doing this manipulation, which method is doing this manipulation. All those things I'm going to tell fourth day or fifth day. Okay. Now just I'm providing the demo now. Don't worry about the functionality. I am saying to everybody, don't worry about the functionality. The fourth day or third, fifth day, I will tell for this manipulation to generate access token, which class we are using. To generate to generate a category, which class we are using. Those things I'm going to tell in separate day. Okay. Okay, next one is we need to create a tax data. Okay, if you want to sell some product, we cannot go directly load the data, right? First, I want to tell some flow. Okay, then I will go for to creating a tax. 1 minute, guys, please bear with me. Okay, if you want to sell a product, we cannot directly go and load the product. Okay, we need to follow some steps. If you want to sell a product, there are many data dependencies. On that product. We need to resolve those data issues, then only we can create the product. We can sell the product. Okay. In order to sell the product, what you have to do? The first step is, I'm saying, we need to add a tax information. Each product having some tax rate, GST, right? If you want to sell clothing, it's a 5%. If you want to sell software as a service, for that 80%. So for each product, we have some GST percentage. That GST percentage, we need to load inside a tax table. First, we need to insert a tax table. Then we need to load the category table. If you want to sell some product, which is a cloth section, the category table we need to populate. Then offer table. These are optional table. Offer table is an optional table. If you want, you can use it. If you want to apply some offer to the product, definitely you need to load the offer table. Okay. After doing this, then you need to load vendor table. There is a one vendor table we need to load. Why? Because, for example, I want to sell t-shirt. To sell a t-shirt, I want to buy that t-shirt from the manufacturer. From the manufacturer or who is doing the wholesale selling, wholesale retailer. I want to buy either wholesale retailer or I want to buy from the manufacturer. Okay, I want to go to the manufacturer. I want to tell, I want to sell some t-shirt. I need to purchase the t-shirt from the manufacturer. That manufacturer is called as a vendor. That vendor information we need to store inside a vendor table. Then once loaded the vendor table, we need to create a purchase order. Okay, let's say I got some 100 t-shirts from the vendor. That 100 t-shirt information, not 100 t-shirt information. For example, I purchased 100 t-shirt from this vendor, from this company. That information we need to load inside a purchase order. Purchase order containing the product information. Then vendor information, that is this purchase order table mapped with the vendor table. Okay. After doing this, from this purchase order, we need to load all the product to the product table. Finally, we need to come to the product table. We cannot go directly inside the product table. So we have this many dependencies. First one is tax, category, offer, then fourth one is vendor, then fifth one is the purchase order. After doing the five step, then we need to populate the product from the purchase order. After populating the product, we need to sell the product. After creating the product, then we are our billing system ready to sell the product to the customer. Okay. If you look at the tax table, here you can see HSN code, tax description, tax percentage. These are three columns, is very, very, very important. See, is deleted, debt created, debt modified, I will explain later. Okay, you don't have to worry about that. Debt created will create the debt whenever you create a row, that time current debt will create it. Okay, whenever you modify, the current debt will store in debt modified. Is deleted is, I will tell later, and you don't have to worry about that. Okay, here you can see HSN code, tax description and the tax percentage. What is HSN code? Okay, HSN code, that code is not created by, it's not created by me, it's a common code. Okay, it's a common code, it's a common for throughout the India. I'm not sure about the international, but throughout the India HSN code is a common. Okay, each HSN code mapped with a set of products. Each HSN code mapped with the same set of product. For example, 6109 is a one valid HSN code. That HSN code mapped with a t-shirt, singlets, vest, knitted and a crocheted. This product mapped with this HSN code. At the same time, this particular HSN code mapped with one GST percentage. That is a 5%. Okay. Whenever you want to tell t-shirt, you need to map this t-shirt to this HSN code. Once you map this t-shirt to HSN code, automatically you come to know that what is the tax percentage of this t-shirt. It is a 5%. In such a way, I designed my database. Here you can see HSN code, tax description and tax percentage. For example, I can see HSN code 610. 610 come HSN code. Then tax description come this product name. Then tax percentage, this percentage will value will come here. Okay. Now I need to create a tax information for this product. Okay. Let's see that now. You understand the concept of HSN code, right? What is the purpose of HSN code? HSN code mapped with some set of product. Set of product as well as mapped with some set of
One question, sir.
So
this HSN code you are saying, right? So is it like related to some product which is like 5% GST? If the product is 12% GST, some another HSN code, will it change with the GST percentage?
Exactly, it will change. There are many HSN code available. For each HSN code, there is a certain product. That HSN code mapped with the one GST percentage. That could be 5%, 12%, or 18%.
Okay, so it is directly proportional to GST. GST, this code, right?
Yeah, correct. Exactly. Yeah.
Okay.
So these are my request. These are request body. I am passing HSN code, tax percentage of 5, tax description. I am saying some description. Okay, I want to load them my tax data. I will tell later how to map this tax data to the product. Okay, you don't have to worry about that now. Now we're going to focus on what is HSN code, how to load the data in the tax table. I'm getting forbidden error. The reason is I'm not passing a valid JSON token. Okay. Copy this. Go to header section. Now send the request. Say created. Successfully created. Say 201 created. Say it's created now. Now we have done with two steps. Which one? We created a category. We created a tax table. Then we need to create an offer table. Now we need to load the offer table. Finally, we'll check that how to map this tax table to this product. That we're going to tell finally, not now. Okay, then This offer table, often this is not offer table. Okay, there is offer table. Yeah. The offer table, we have offer code, offer name, offer description, status. These many fields that we have. Now I want to load the offer table. So I'm passing the offer. See, for all object, right? See, this all for all request type, I have one Java class. That Java class available here. DTO. In the DTO packet, everything is a request object. For whatever request I'm sending from the client, for that request equivalent Java object available here. That is a I will call it as address info, base info, billing info, then offer info. Everything available here. Okay, in the DTO package, data transfer object. This is a data transfer object. Why? Because I don't want to share. I don't want to share the entity that. What can I say that I want anyway, I want to store this information, right? This information I don't, this object I don't want to pass in persistent layer. I don't want to pass. At the same time, I don't want to access entity object inside a container, inside a controller object. Okay, so for that I'm using this DTO descent pattern to convert. If you look at here, entity object, there is an offer class. Each and every request object, there is an equivalent entity object. Okay, whenever you map whatever value I'm sending from here, whatever value I'm sending from here, this value populated in offer info object, then from this offer info object I am migrating this data, whatever value available here. For example, in this case, offer name 5%, description and active, this information mapped to this particular attribute, right? This attribute automatically migrate to the offer entity object. I am not doing any code for that. For that, I am using one framework called MapStruct. MapStruct is a mapping framework to convert one object to another object. One object to another object. I am using that framework here. Whenever you populate this object, whenever you send it to the service class uses that MapStruct framework. That MapStruct framework convert this offer info to offer entity object. Then using this offer entity object, I am storing the data to the database. The same flow I am doing for everything. The same flow I am doing for everything. Okay. Now I'm going to store the offer name. Let's see. I want to check one thing here. Offer is offer code, offer ID. Now I want to copy the JSON token, right? I want to copy the JSON token. See, offer created. Okay, offer created. Look at the offer table. It's offer created. Okay. Now I want to tell. Yeah, I think today is enough. My time is 7 p.m. now. Tomorrow we'll go into continue other flow. We have completed so far till offer, right? Till offer we have completed. We need to get a purchase order. Then we need to get a product. Then we need to get a. Then we need to sell a product. This billing system is a, we need to sell a product. Once we've done that, I'm going to explain what are all the Spring Boot feature I'm using. I'm going to explain that. Okay. That is a high level walkthrough of the code. Any questions so far?
So, can we put it this in our resume? This product?
Yeah, definitely you can put, yes. That is the intention of this program. Once I share the project, okay, you play with that project. After 5th day, definitely you can able to play with the project, understand the flow, understand that what are the framework I'm using, like a MapStruct, I'm using Lambok, then I'm using JWT. See, this thing, just understand that very high level. That is, whenever ask any question in the interview, you can able to tell, I'm using JWT. They will ask you immediately, what is JWT? you should be able to explain, right? So you can learn it after completion of 5 days. Spend some time daily, learn it. You can put this project in your resume.
Okay.
Sir, be sharing profile collection also along with code.
Sorry. Yes, sir. I have here. In the project, you can see here, right? In the project, there is a section called resource JSON request. I have all the JSON request here.
Okay.
I have all the JSON request here. If anything missed, I will update. Please let me know if any JSON request missed, I will update. Okay. Also, you can watch my YouTube channel. The up to the purchase order, I posted everything in my YouTube channel. Okay, you can go and watch also. If you have any question, let me know through my WhatsApp. I will help you out. But already there is a JSON updated here. You can use this JSON. Give me a time for 1 hour. I will update this code to in the Google Drive. I'll share it to all the people. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
How are you feeling? The session is going well, or are you feeling bad?
No, it is good, sir.
Okay. It's good, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's good.
Okay, tomorrow we'll go to continue next of the piece. Okay. Thank you very much, guys. Okay. I'm leaving now. Okay.
Okay. Thank you so much for session.
Thank you, sir. Thanks, sir.
So please share the link if possible for the today's session.
Yeah, definitely I will share it. Okay.
Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.